Thank you, John. So my charge today is to try to help guide you on the correct patients and the correct tests. And the vast majority of my talk is going to actually still be centered around the esophagus. Without further ado, I'll go forward. So did you know that GI motility disorders account for nearly half of all outpatient gastroenterology clinic visits? So you are seeing a huge, huge amount of these patients. And most gastroenterologists will see one new case, or at least one new case of achalasia per year in their practice. The interesting thing about this is that the achalasia diagnosis is typically missed in 20 to 50% of cases. It's diagnosed by an alternate physician who the patient presents to with the same complaints. And the time from the initial presentation to a doctor to the diagnosis can be years in times, with multiple other different types of conditions being treated. So the two main questions that come from that are, who are the most appropriate patients that may benefit from motility testing, specifically of the esophagus, and what are the appropriate tests to then offer these patients? So the caveat to my talk is the following. There really are no perfect patients, and there are no perfect tests. And the tests that we choose to do, what's really important, is that it has to be done well, and it has to be interpreted correctly. And one of the things that I'm sure Dr. Pandolfino would agree upon is that a lot of our tests have become much easier to do and seemingly much easier to interpret. And I think a lot of people could fall into this box related to that, and there still is a lot of hands-on that we actually have to do to go into the software to make sure that we're interpreting the tests correctly. So what are the right tests? In general, when I see a patient that I believe has some type of motility problem, this list that I show you, in general, most of them are getting at least one, two, if not all of these tests at some point in time in their diagnostic pathway. And they include an upper endoscopy with a biopsy, potentially with an endoscopic ultrasound, a barium esophagram, certainly high-resolution manometry, as we've seen some already, pH analysis with or without impedance, a gastric emptying study, and even, as John had showed us, endoflip. But it's not necessary to include all of these, or certainly to include this in this kind of order. So the one thing that I want to highlight a little bit about is, especially when you're dealing with esophageal motility disorders, is the play of an esophagram in this. And this is really a dying type of technology. And the reason for that is our radiological colleagues, this is not something that is really a part, basically, of their training education. And especially the type of quality esophagram that we need to help us diagnose our patients. So if you look at this report, and the radiologist that I work with in Cornell is in his mid-80s, and I can tell you, I spent a lot of time making sure that his medical care is well given, because I want him around for a long time. So when you look at this study, there's a lot of things on this study. They're talking about the position of the patient. He's talking about what he's giving the patient, a tablet, a pill, a meal, the barium, the timing of the barium. I promise you, if you go back to your institutions, many of these radiological reports look nothing like this, and I'm sure many of your reports sound something like this. To and through emotion, tertiary, blah, 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 and that's the whole report. And that really is not exactly what we need. So there was a lovely article that came out by Joel Richter in 2011 that reviewed really the essence of a great esophagram. And I would urge you to actually look at this. And if you're not convinced that your institution or your radiologist are giving you what you need, you might actually want to provide them with this citation. So there's no way to talk about motility testing or motility-like patients without looking a little bit deeper into high-resolution manometry. And in order for me to actually be able to show you some of the cases, I want to give you a just brief primer on manometry and what we're looking at when we actually do this. So in essence, there are five different metrics that we basically are looking at when we're doing high-resolution manometry, and these are here. They're the integrated residual pressure, they're the distal latency, the distal contractile interval, the peristaltic integrity, and the pressurization pattern. I'm not going to go totally into depth of all these things, but it's much easier for me to make sure that you know where someone is coming from when they're talking about your patients if you understand these different metrics. So basically, when we talk about the IRP, in essence, what we're discussing is how well does the lower esophageal sphincter, how well does it relax after the initial swallow? And as John had already shown us, a big portion of the Chicago criteria has to do with deciding whether or not someone's IRP, or relaxation of their lower esophageal sphincter, is normal or not. The distal latency essentially is a metric that we're looking at to decide upon spastic contractions, and it has to do with how quickly the swallow, the peristalsis of the swallow is going down, and how acute the angle is of that swallow. The distal contractile interval, essentially this has to do with the vigor of the swallow. How strong is the swallow? The integrity, the peristaltic integrity, is whether or not there are breaks in the swallow as it goes down. Are they large breaks, which are qualified as greater than 5 centimeters? Are there no breaks? Is it a smooth swallow from the upper esophageal sphincter down to lower esophageal sphincter? And lastly, it's the pressurization pattern. So based upon whether or not there are issues which are affecting the integrity of the lower esophageal sphincter or the upper esophageal sphincter, you can have compartmentalized pressurization, or you can have panesophageal pressurization. So just as John had briefly shown, what are we looking for in high-resolution manometry? Well, these are the different disorders that basically they can get broken down to. Now, these are manometric disorders. These don't necessarily tell you what is wrong with your patient. Aside from achalasia and the subtypes, in here you don't really see specific diagnoses. You know, is this related to GERD? Is this related to a tumor? Is this related to systemic sclerosis? But these are the manometric findings, and then we have to extrapolate based upon our patient's history and the other tests we do. But the top five, these are manometric findings that are just not seen in normal subjects. So if you see these type of manometric findings, you know that there's some pathological issue going on with your patient. Interpreting it goes through a hierarchical approach based upon different virtues, the first starting with that IRP and then going through the other parameters as I had outlined. So, if we were now to look more closely at the tests, what's the utility of an esophagram versus high-resolution manometry in the detection of esophageal dysmotility? I'm saying to you that I really do use this quite often in my practice, and how well does it actually hold up to high-resolution manometry? So this was a recent retrospective study that came out in 2016 from Don Castell's group, and it was looking at just that question. He looked at, in table one, you see the different indications, which are pretty classic indications for why someone would present with esophageal symptomatology, going from things like heartburn, cough, chest pain. And he looked at those patients, and then they did a high-resolution manometry. And these were the diagnoses that came out from the high-resolution manometry and the percentage of patients. After that, he did an esophagram, or he looked at the esophagram results in all these patients, and you can see here that the specificity is pretty reasonable in comparison to the high-resolution manometry, but the sensitivity is not that great. So in essence, from this study, we can glean that the esophagram is useful in the assessment, let's say, of structural or anatomic abnormalities, but it really is a poor screening exam for dysmotility. So if you have, for instance, a patient that's presenting with a classic motility problem that you believe they have, or most certainly dysphagia, they should be referred for high-resolution manometry regardless of the esophagram results. Now, what about that high-resolution manometry? I mean, it certainly is a fantastic test. Dr. Pandolfino showed us how it's really made a huge difference in us being able to, number one, diagnose achalasia, but certainly in terms of stratifying the type of achalasia. But is it fantastic? Is this really the holy grail of tests for us? Well, this was an interesting study that was done to look to see how well do we do between different readers. And it compared conventional manometry versus high-resolution manometry. And we can see here, and this included physicians that were actually early readers and also expert readers. And you can see by this study that even in expert readers, that we're not perfect, actually, reading between the two. But certainly from this, it looks as if high-resolution manometry does seem to be somewhat better than conventional. So if you are someone who's still doing conventional manometry, or if you're referring to people to do it, this might be something that would prompt you to actually move on to high-resolution manometry. So who is the right patient? Well, I would say that if we were thinking about motility issues in our patients, these would be the symptoms that would prompt me to think there is potentially a motility problem going on, and I should move on to additional studies that would help me define it. And the symptomatology would be that of non-obstructive dysphagia, non-cardiac chest pain, regurgitation, and even refractory heartburn. So case number one. This is a 72-year-old male who's a former smoker who presents with a history of GERD, hypertension, and an 8-month history of progressive dysphagia. An upper endoscopy had been performed 14 months ago for worsening reflux and a revealed grade B, LA grade B esophagitis. He accommodated his diet and is currently eating only mechanical soft consistency of food because of his symptoms. And he's lost 20 pounds over the past 4 months. So, what do you think is going on? I mean, this is what starts to go through my mind when I see a patient like this. Is this erosive esophagitis with refractory reflux and he has this because he's non-compliant with his medicines? Is this refractory reflux and he now has a stricture and that's why he has the dysphagia? Is this progressive dysphagia because there's actually a functional obstruction there? Or is this progressive dysphagia because there's a motility disorder that has not declared itself or been diagnosed? So what's the right test to do in this patient? Well, in this patient, because he's had an upper endoscopy and there's been still some ongoing dysphagia, I want to see, is there something structural that's going on? And I can tell you, there are times when we do upper endoscopies that subtle structural abnormalities, like rings and webs, and even not completely obstructing strictures, can be missed. And so on this barium esophagram, you can see that there's a column of barium that's hanging up in the esophagus. And the esophagus looks a little bit dilated, and there's some tapering at the bottom of the esophagram, and this is done with thin liquids and a solid. And the radiologist at that time had given, this was done outside of our institution, but he gave this individual a diagnosis of achalasia. So it struck me a little funny, a 72-year-old man, he's lost all this weight, he'd not really had anything other than heartburn for years and years, and now all of a sudden he has a new diagnosis of achalasia, so I thought we needed to move on to more tests. So we did a high-resolution manometry on this individual, and there was, the IRP was high on this high-resolution manometry, the relaxation of the EGJ was somewhat impaired, and you go through this hierarchical approach that was based upon that different schema that we'd shown you. So the IRP was elevated, and then we go to assess the peristalsis. Is it completely failed? No. Is there paraesophageal pressurization? No. Is there some evidence of peristalsis? Yes. So based upon the Chicago classification, this individual has something called EGJ outflow obstruction. And you may see these findings handed to you by, or you may do them on your own, but you may see some of these findings handed to you by people that do manometry. And I'd say to myself, EGJ outflow obstruction, you know, what does that mean? I mean, what's wrong with my patient? What do they actually have? Well, so one of the other things that are seen on this manometry is that there's an increased area, the intrabolus pressure is actually elevated on this patient as well. So based upon those things, I started to become more concerned, is there actually some kind of functional obstruction in this patient? So even though he'd had previously done by another physician an upper endoscopy, I said, we need to repeat this upper endoscopy, so we do it. And the EGJ looks somewhat distorted to me, and when I pass the scope through it, I get pressure, not the pressure of a pop, like just an achalasia, but real pressure to navigate that scope through, and some oozing happens with scope passage. So then I choose to do an endoscopic ultrasound because of the abnormality there, and we can see that there's actually somewhat expansion of the submucosa and the muscularis propria, but no lymphadenopathy, and this came back biopsy by FNA as a carcinoma. There was a recent study that was done looking at EUS as being a nice adjunctive in patients to sort of add in our diagnosis after high-resolution manometry. So what's my patient's diagnosis? This is pseudoachalasia. So this was an older man, rapidly progressive dysphagia, profound weight loss. And it's a term that's used to describe the clinical picture of G-junction obstruction, most classically by tumor. And it can present in 5% of patients with radiologic and manometric diagnosis of achalasia. So a thorough workup would then obviously implore us to continue down the line of doing testing, even though we'd actually done some of it in the past. Case two. This is now a 32-year-old female with a 3-year history of Raynaud's and reflux. In past, her GERD had been controlled with daily PPI, and over the past 6 months, her heartburn has increased significantly, and she presents now with progressive dysphagia. So an upper endoscopy is done on her, And one of the things that John had even commented on is when you go in and you do the upper endoscopy, there's a whole bunch of saliva that's sitting there. And that's one thing that I'd like to just as a clinical pearl as well. Lots of times when we do an upper endoscopy, we don't necessarily actually look at things like that. Like, are there collections of a little bit of secretions? Just secretions in the bottom of the esophagus. Does this esophagus look boggy to me? Does it look dilated? And then after the secretions were cleared, grade 3 erosive esophagitis becomes evident. So what are you thinking is going on now in this patient? It's basically the same list. Is this erosive esophagitis? You know, coming down to why did they have dysphagia? Is this maybe also motility disorder that's still going on? So she initially improves with BID PPI and a strict lifestyle management of her GERD. And in spite of this, the dysphagia progresses and she incurs a 15-pound weight loss over 3 months. And over the past month, she also has an episode of pneumonia. So what's the right test in this person? She's not better, even though there was erosive esophagitis and you put her on the right treatment supposedly, which is a PPI, she's just not better. So in this patient as well, because of the dysphagia, I then do a barium esophagram. And on this barium esophagram, I'll just show you in comparison to what another one would look like. Here we can see from normal to our patient, the column is staying persistent with the barium. The esophagus looks dilated, and there's maybe some tapering at the end of this esophagus. So I move on then to a high-resolution manometry, and on this you can see, here we can see the upper esophageal sphincter, and do we see anything really reminiscent of the lower? No, it's a very low pressure, and there's basically, it's all quiet here on the manometry, really no evidence of peristalsis. So we again do that hierarchical approach to the Schnoll classification, and in this woman, the IRP is not elevated. In fact, the LES pressure is low, but there's absence of peristalsis. So this, too, is a major disorder of peristalsis. It's absent contractility by the Schnoll classification. And this is what this would look like in comparison to a normal swallow. So I then say to myself, absent peristalsis, what's that? What's wrong with my patient? So I think about her now. She has Raynaud's, erosive esophagitis, pneumonia, a normal IRP, absent of peristalsis, and a hypotensive LES. And what we're looking at here is scleroderma. So this is a type of a disorder that presents, it's an autoimmune disorder that it develops as the smooth muscle of the esophagus is replaced by scar tissue. And these patients, the treatment must be aimed at aggressively controlling the underlying reflux disease. And typically we have to do things like 24-hour pH analysis to make sure that we're very aggressively treating their reflux. Case 3, 23-year-old woman referred for evaluation of regurgitation, and she has rare heartburn. Her symptoms have progressed significantly over the past year, and she's become noticeable to her spouse. And he thinks she actually has some kind of eating disorder because she sees she's effortlessly able to just bring up food, and he tells me that he actually thinks that she's a bulimic. And he starts to call her out on the times when she's doing this. So she's on PPIs, and it makes no difference, and she has an upper endoscopy, which is normal, and she has a 24-hour pH test, which is normal. So what's the right test for this patient? Well, on manometry in this patient, we can see actually what's interesting that's happening on her is that she's able to generate an enormous amount of pressure in her stomach, and that pressure is able to overcome the lower esophageal sphincter, and she's able to actually push the food that she recently ingested up into her esophagus. And then she will sometimes have it in her mouth and she'll re-swallow it. And there is a Rome criteria for this syndrome. This is rumination syndrome. And we can actually help these patients if we diagnose it. But I can tell you that these patients go on for a long time without getting diagnosed. And diaphragmatic breathing, where you actually take inspiratory and expiratory breaths with the abdominal muscles and keep the chest motion very quiet, this behavioral change can make a huge difference in this patient population. So, last case. 75-year-old female, more than a 20-year history of recurrent episodes of intermittent solid food dysphagia and chest pain. She's diagnosed 20 years ago with esophageal spasms, and she's been given a huge amount of treatments, dilations, Botox, Levsin, nitroglycerin. She is no better in spite of all of this. So I see her, and I do a barium esophagram on her, and these are the swallows. And what you see here is diffuse esophageal spasm, a mild corkscrew appearance, there's a loss of the peristaltic wave, and the distal esophagus actually becomes like a beak-like narrow tapering. And this is her high-resolution manometry. And on it, we're able to see that the IRP is elevated and that there's some panesophageal pressurization. Now, the irony of this case is that this woman is diagnosed with achalasia after more than 20 years of being symptomatic, and I'm going to show you why this is so ironic. If you look over here, what's circled here, now I'm not sure if any of you really noticed my name, but the last name of this person is Schnoll. My name happens to be Schnoll-Sussman. So this is actually my mother that I diagnosed about a month ago with achalasia. So she's actually going to be referred, she's going to have a poem done in November, but this is someone under my nose that went for 20 years. So my take-home points are this. Do not use one technology as a sole arbiter of a diagnosis. You must keep a high level of suspicion to diagnose motility disorders. Sometimes you have to repeat a test to make the right diagnosis, but do it well at that time. And listen to your patient. They're usually right. Thank you so much for your time.